Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Winter Vow by Tim Akers, narrated by Matt Leisy. Prologue. The blessed forces of the celestial church lined the field, banners flowing, rank upon rank of spear and arrow, joined by the holy cadres of inquisitors. The might of Cinder filled them. The glory of their god hung over them like a storm cloud. "This will be a good day, Frevo clan," the sergeant said. He was dressed in the black and gold of the church's livery, the mail of his coif as bright as moonlight, the rose's spear and shield stretched off in both directions, the men eager for battle, the priest chanting rites of blessing. "It will be a day of judgment," Vauclan answered, his stiff fingers going through the motions of the blessing without thought. He stepped to the next man, a child whose helm settled too low on his brow, and started the rite over again. "Judgment is sometimes good, and sometimes harrowing," he mumbled to himself, "but it is always necessary." The soldiers ignored his words, their eyes turned to the bright fields below. The army of the rebel houses of Tener perched narrowly on the opposite rise, their thin ranks bolstered by the banners of a few Sudran dukes. The forests of the Fen hung black and forbidding in the background, and the Reeveholt loomed to the east. Vauclan didn't see how Malcolm Blakeley could lead men to such obvious slaughter. The Sudran loyalists, commanded by Lady Bastion, Duchess of Galleydeep, outnumbered Blackley's force nearly 3-1. That was before the ranks of the army of Cinder were counted. Blackley's defeat was inevitable. Still, the man seemed determined to fight. "Stubborn," Vauclan said as he finished his prayers and turned to join his brothers at the core of the celestial contingent. He had met Duke Blakeley once, at the Frost Night celebration nearly a decade ago. Houndhallow had seemed a reasonable man, faithful to the church, and gifted with Cinder's reason. "The years change a man, I suppose. A pity." A drum roll surged through the valley, calling the army to attention. Vauclan took his place among the holy priests of Cinder. The gods' vengeance would be exacted on Tener. It was a tragedy that would take generations to mend, but there was no other way. At the front of the Sudran army, a trio of priests climbed the stairs to a rickety platform to address the ranks. They wore simple black robes, but the glint of mail flashed at their hems, and their faces were buried in shadowy hoods. The murmur of steel and leather and the voices of nervous soldiers flowed like a tide over the army, and Vauclan was worried that the priest's words would be lost to the wind. He watched nervously as the tallest of the three priests stepped forward. "Odd that he wears no ornament," Vauclan said. "It was the High Elector of Cinder who led us out of Hartsbridge. I wonder where Dustas is."
"Probably transcribing Cinder's only law," Frere de Lou joked at his side. The two had been together since their investiture. Life on the road didn't agree with de Lou, but the smaller priest still seemed excited at the prospect of battle.
"The old man always gets carried away with that."
Vauclan was about to answer when the priest on the platform started to speak. The words were strangely distant, as though they echoed from across the valley or from the clouds above. The babble of the army quieted as everyone strained to hear what the priest was saying. The silence was eerie. It was unnatural. "What is happening?" Vauclan asked, but his words died at his lips. He turned frantically to de Lou, only to see that the man was staring with horror down at his hands. Vauclan grabbed him by the shoulder. De Lou looked up and started talking, but no words came out of his mouth. A black fog formed at his lips, drifting like smoke from a snuffed candle. The silence was absolute. Even Vauclan's heartbeat, thudding heavily in his chest, was muted. Into the silence came a scream, sharp, tearing, without direction, but
utterly terrified. Everyone looked up, but the sun still shone. The sky was clear. The scream died out, only to be joined by another, and another, coming from all around Vauclan. Coming from his own mouth, passing through him like a wave, and then on to Delu and the priests beyond. The force of it emptied his lungs, and when he tried to breathe, there was no air to fill him. Vauclan dropped to his knees. Delu fell by his side, tongue lolling, the blood of his heart pouring from his eyes. Vauclan held his friend and watched him die. The world rushed in with a crash, the sound of an army's panic suddenly filling Vauclan's head. Someone stumbled into Vauclan, a knight in full plate, treading on Delu's throat. There was fighting somewhere nearby, people dying, steel striking steel and flesh and bone. A boy fell down next to Vauclan, his chest split open. "What is happening?" Vauclan asked again, his heart numb. The blood rushing through his head was a drumbeat. He stood up and looked around. People were dying. The army was dying. At the head of the army, the three priests stood on the platform, their arms raised in prayer, their voices resonant. An inhuman chant rolled out of their throats, words meant to twist flesh and sunder spirit. Dark gods answered their prayers, tearing into the ranks of Sudran faithful. Vauclan got to his feet and ran. Each step sent a jolt of pain down Vauclan's spine. Something was broken deep inside his chest, but he pressed on. God's help him, he had to press on. It had been 3 weeks since the ambush. 3 weeks spent crawling through forests, forsaken by God and man, eating whatever greenery looked edible, and still getting sick half the time. Vauclan tried eating some meat from a dead deer he found at the bottom of a gully, but the resulting misery ensured he would never do that again. The fact he hadn't died could only be attributed to Cinder's will. Vauclan was sure of it. He paused on the rocky spine of a ridge. In the fading light of dusk, the dark towers of the Fen Gate loomed grimly out of the forest to the northeast. It wasn't where he wanted to be, but after the slaughter, Vauclan had lost his mind. Cinder's reason fled. The horror still haunted him, waking and sleeping. Sometimes Vauclan was sure the dreams were true, and this daylight ordeal of trackless forests and maggot-ridden meat was the nightmare. A shadow flickered down the ridge, and Vauclan flinched. The screams of his brothers and sisters lingered in his mind. The look on Delu's face as his spirit left, his lungs starved and full of blood. Vauclan had not been able to shrive his friend's soul, hadn't taken the time to usher the man into the quiet house. He wondered if anyone had. He doubted it. They were haunting him, these bound souls, bound to him for running, bound to him for his cowardice. There was only one way to free himself from them, one way to give the souls of Delu the rest they deserved. He had to get to the Fen Gate, to tell Frere Gilliam what had happened, that Blakeley had used some kind of witchcraft against them, or that they had been betrayed by priests still loyal to Sacombra, or by their own god. The thought chilled him. "The Orphan Shield will know," Vauclan muttered to himself. "He will know what to do." He stumbled forward, shying away from the growing shadows along the ridgeline, refusing to look in their direction. The spirits of Delu and the others, the spirits of the dead. "He must know. I must tell him." "You mustn't, actually." The voice came from the shadows, drifting like fog through the forest. Dreams again. Dreams among the living. Vauclan was beginning to think he was going mad. Better to press on, to flee. But as Vauclan hurried away from the shadows, something came out of them. A man, dressed in the glory of cinder. We will see to that, my friend. Vauclin paused and turned. The man descended from the ridgeline, grabbing at the trees for support as he slid down the steep incline, very like flesh and blood, not a ghost. He was dressed in black robes and silver armor, and his hood was thrown back. When the setting sun peeked through the trees and found the man's face, it shone off golden hair and a nose that had been broken more than once. The man smiled at Vauclin.
"You needn't look so surprised, Frere," he said. "You made it much farther than we thought possible. Most of your compatriots went to Blakeley for protection, or tried their luck south, hoping to reach Hartsbridge." He slowed as he reached Vauclin, folding his arms into his robes.
"Those who scattered into the fen are dead.
All but you. Frere Vauclin, isn't it?"
"How did you know?"
"We still hold a stake in the realm of dreams. Cinder has left us that much, even those who have turned fully toward..."
He paused, gesturing emptily toward the sky.
"Those who have taken another path. I am Frere Morrow."
"You are part of Gilliam's cadre?
You look too old to be one of the Orphan's Shield's wards," Vauclin said.
"Take me to him. He must be warned."
"No," Morrow said. "He mustn't."
Morrow raised a hand. His palm was scored in black, like a wound that hadn't healed properly. And as Vauclin's eyes lingered, it seemed to change. Dark lines crawled across the skin. They drew Vauclin in, until he realized that he had unknowingly walked closer to the mysterious priest. Vauclin shook his head and stepped away.
"What are you doing?" Vauclin asked.
The sun had set, and shadows filled the forest around them.
"Cinder and Strife, what have you done?"
"What is necessary," Morrow said, and then the darkness of his palm filled Vauclin's mind, and he fell.
Part 1. Threats and Reversals. Chapter 1. Sharp pain burned through Ian's chest. The wound was open like cracked earth, and the edges of his flesh were crusted with blood. Worked into his flesh, the fragments of the Void Father's amulet pulsed with malevolent red light. Streamers of fog danced up from the wound to tangle with the witch's fingers. Her eyes were closed in concentration. The only sound was the hum of her chant and Ian's pained groans. His sweat stained the sheets of the bed, and his fingers dug into the mattress. Finally, he could take no more.
"Enough!"
Ian snapped, turning away. The spell broke, and the pain subsided.
"It feels like you're yanking a fish hook through my ribs."
"I don't understand," Maeve said. Carl had sent her when he had learned of Ian's wound, insisting she was the best healer the tribes had to offer. But Ian didn't think she was doing much good.
"Your life energy is strong, but the wound resists me. You're not dying, though. At least, not today."
"Very comforting," Ian muttered. He sat up, delicately running a finger along the edge of the wound. The flesh was hot, and as hard as baked clay.
"I've always wanted an impressive scar, though this is not exactly what I had in mind."
"Women think lesser scars than you might believe," Maeve said. "It does little for your charm, and speaks to a life of violence and risk."
"That's not what I..." "Never mind. A pity Fiona isn't here. She was able to bring my mother back from the brink of death. I have trouble believing that this would cause her any difficulty."
"It's true. Fiona was skilled in water's gifts of healing." Maeve stood and began packing her instruments.
"Though considering it was her father who inflicted this injury on you, I don't know that I'd seek her aid if I were you."
"So, Folum really was her father?"
"Many whisper that she was to be the Void Mother when Folum set that burden down. If she knew of her father's betrayal..."
Maeve shrugged. Anyway, she's not here. And I am. And I say that wound can't be healed. Well, thankfully, it doesn't hurt very much, Ian said. But his mind was elsewhere. What did Fianna know of her father's sins? Was she part of it? Everything she told him about seeking the hound, about following the old ways of Tenere, had all of that been part of the deception? Good. Perhaps your southern gods can heal you. Now that Folum is dead, we may never learn what he did to you. Ian sat quietly for a while, thinking. When he turned, the witch was gone, and he was alone in the room. There was a knock at the door. Sir Chloe came in a heartbeat later. She wore a shirt of simple chain over her linens, but looked as ready for war as if she'd been in full plate. Her dark eyes took in the room, checking each corner thoroughly before resting on Ian. Chloe settled into a stance of loose attention. My lord, may I have a word? Does it have to be now? Ian was trying not to blush under the knight's steely glare. He barely knew Chloe. They were nearly the same age, but her family was from much farther north than his. She had come to Houndhallow to petition for a place in his father's service, shortly before the Allfire last year. So much had happened since then. Didn't I leave you in charge of my sister's safety? And it is of her safety I would speak, my lord. If I may... Stop calling me lord. Malcolm Blakeley is the lord of Hanhallow, and I'm not sure he would pass the throne to me. Not after... Ian trailed off, remembering his father's words at the Fen Gate, the simple dismissal that sent Ian into exile. This is not my throne to sit. You are the oldest Blakeley present. There has been no word of Lord Blakeley since he quit the Fen Gate, so in the absence of his authority, I must make my petition to you. Chloe made the slightest bow, her face placid. Whether you want it or nay. Ian sighed, but the movement sent a jolt of pain through his chest, causing him to inhale sharply. Chloe took a step forward. I saw the witch leave with a smug look on her face. Did she fix you, or did she make it worse? She asked. No worse, thank the gods, but no better. It seems there's nothing to be done for me. Ian stood and nearly lost his balance, catching himself on the bedpost. It will pass. Not everything passes. Some things only get worse, Chloe said. It's for the better that the witch wasn't able to help you. I don't trust these pagans. Well, I would be dead without their help. And this castle, fallen. They may not be the allies we expect, but they are the allies the gods have given us. I remember standing watch on this very tower at your sister's side, as these same pagans swarmed the walls and crashed our gates. Odd behavior for allies. Not the same pagans. If Folum and his lot can be called that anymore. Ian grimaced as he belted on his sword. The tribes were tricked into assaulting Houndhallow by Folum and his void priests. They lost as many honest souls to Folum's betrayal as we did. And the souls we lost fell to pagan blades. Sir Tavish held the door to his tower against the hope of reinforcement and nearly died with a pagan spear in his gut. He's only now up and walking, and I swear the wound has changed that man. It was not this void father who threw that blade. Chloe's palm brushed the hilt of her dagger. You can weigh your alliances in trickery and false promises. I weigh mine in blood. The weight of blood is more than any of us will be able to pay. Not in our lifetimes, at least. I am willing to make the effort. Chloe answered, staring up at the wall. They are not the enemy, Chloe. Not in this. Ian pulled his shirt back on, grimacing as the fabric pulled across the cracked flesh of his wound. Folum would have us believe otherwise, but I am done dancing to the Void Father's dirge. I am no longer part of his game. Aren't you? Chloe asked. Stories I heard out of the Fengate Say you arrived in the arms of one of these witches, the same one taken south by the Inquisition. And now we stand in the company of Gwendolyn Adair. Chloe made a slow circuit of the room as she spoke. When she reached the door, she peered outside, then pressed it shut and lowered her voice. I don't need to tell you what I think of House Adair. The Adairs were betrayed by our true enemy, Sicombra. It was the High Inquisitor who started this war. First you blame this pagan, Folum, and now the High Inquisitor. You make this hard to believe, my lord. It has been a complicated time, but Sicombra... I have nothing to say about Thomas Sicombra, Chloe interrupted. You tell me he committed heresy, raised a pagan god of the dead, and murdered the Adairs. That he murdered Duke Calvert and framed your father. You tell me these things, and that is all I know. You don't believe me. If I did not believe you, we would not be having this conversation. But believing them and knowing them to be true are different things, my lord. The knight came closer, bending her head toward Ian. Her features were soft, more suited for a lady of the court than a knight, but she had murder in her eyes. And what I know to be true is this. These people attacked your home. Call them pagans or the northern tribes or whatever you like. There are men and women wearing Blakeley colours who are dead today because of them. Now they walk your hallways and eat your bread and shelter inside your walls. And why? Because of some story about this Void Father. You were there, Chloe. You saw him raise a geist. Saw it tear through the pagans just as much as it tore through our people. You know what he was capable of. What I saw was another pagan, killing priests and good celestials. When you led us into battle, you claimed to ride for all Tenumbra. That's good enough, but you have to ride for your family first. They depend on you. And what am I supposed to do? Folum is dead, and his priests are fled. There is something in the forest, hunting any who dare leave these walls. Should I throw Gwen and her tribesmen into the forest, just as winter is falling, to be killed by feral gods? Is this what justice looks like to you? Justice doesn't matter. Justice died with Folum, and we've no hope of that. What you need to do is protect your family. There has been no word from your father since Frere Gilliam drove him out of the Fengate. Gods know what became of your mother. Or if she's even human anymore. Your sister is here, Ian, and she's depending on you. House Blakeley, all these men and women wearing the hound and swearing to the hallow, they depend on you. Chloe looked down at the bed where some of the witch's tools remained. What are they to think of their lord, keeping counsel with pagans, seeking a witch's healing? Are you even their lord anymore? My father is their lord. My father who exiled me at the Fen Gate and turned his back on the witch who saved his wife's life, my mother's life. These people shouldn't be looking to me for leadership. But we do, because we have no one else. Chloe took Ian by the shoulders and looked him square in the eye. I swore a vow to your father, stood at your sister's side, would have died to keep her alive. And that vow descends to you. For my sister's safety, I thank you. But your vow should be to her. I am not ready for the throne, Ian said, pulling away. My father will return. Until then, Hound Hallow will have to see to itself. Chloe was silent for a minute, staring daggers at Ian. When she spoke, her voice held violence. What did they do to you, Blakeley? Stories say you were alone with the pagans for months, and when you returned, you looked more tribesman than Duke's son. You've been running from your family ever since. So I ask, what did the witch do to you? Fiona saved my life, Ian said. But even as the words left his mouth, his mind rebelled. Why did she save you, Ian? To use you against your father? Against your family? She's Folum's daughter. Surely she knew. He shook his head and continued. She and Carl led me through the fen and to my father's side. Without their help, that battle might have been lost. And my father thanked her by sending her south with the Inquisition. Is Gwenadera a heretic? Chloe asked suddenly. What? Yes, of course. By her own admission, but that's not... And Sacombra? He is also a heretic, yes? Yes. And a murderer as well. Murderer in war is a difficult thing to judge. Sacombra has gone south, chained to the witch Fianna, to be judged. But Gwen walks free. Why? Who are you to ask these questions? A soldier of Tenere, sworn to your house. I have fought fewer battles than you, my lord, but I have seen war enough. I have lost more friends to these pagans than I care to count. I have learned to be wary, especially of the enemy who claims to be my friend. So tell me, why does Gwenadair walk free? Is her heresy somehow a lesser one than Sacombra's? Are the dead at her feet not deserving of life? Tell me, my lord. I don't know. That's not mine to judge. You are the heir of Handhalo. We are in your halls, under your roof, surrounded by men and women who have sworn their lives to you. I have sworn my life to you. Your word is law. It is yours to judge and no one else's. Unless you'd rather trust the Inquisition to answer that question. Chloe smiled mirthlessly and spread her hands. Because I think we all know what they would decide. Gwen Adair and her tribes were just as much the victims of the Voidfather as we were. They were tricked into this attack, and while I mourn the dead, I will not add to their number without reason. Ian drew himself up and faced Chloe. There is something more going on here. Whatever Folum planned, he wanted us to fight. Sudrin against Tenarin, Celestial against Pagan. Just as much the victims. Chloe shook her head. This is how I count, my lord. How many hundreds are dead? Sudrin names. Tenarin names. Dead at Pagan hands. And you believe them? It's not what I believe, Ian said. It's what I know. I know Gwenadair lost everything to Sacombra's plot and Folum's blade, more than I have lost. Aye, Gwenadair. Between her shaman and your witch, we all have a lot to lose. Her shaman? Ian asked. Aye, brute of a fellow named Carl. Looks like a rock most of the time and talks less. He's the one who brought the Adair girl here. Did he? Ian's voice grew distant. Carl, whose witching wife was Fianna, the very man who walked by Ian's side through the fen. What was his loyalty to Folum? Did he indeed? Sir Brûlé sat in a corner of the courtyard by himself, sharpening his blade. A crowd of Teneran soldiers sat on the other side of the fire, talking among themselves and ignoring the Sudrin knight. Brûlé watched them out of the corner of his eye. Nearly had them, one of the Tenarans said. He was a scrawny kid with a scar that split his lip in two. It was me and Master Tavish holding off the lot. Lucky for them, Master Ian came back when he did. It was the heretic bitch who stopped the pagans, not you, his friend said. Called them to heel like dogs. Well, it weren't like that, Huck answered. No Blackley soul owes their life to Gwenadair. We held them back. Hell you did, another said. Master Ian gave his word, then rushed off with his southern knights, and Adair gave the pagans the order to retreat. The man spat into the fire, his eyes passing briefly over Brûlé. Saved by Sudrin blades and pagan whores. Better to have fallen. It was Sudra what started this war. And pagans, what kept it burning, Huck said. There'll be no peace in Tenere until they're both gone. God's bless, they murmured as one, more than a few eyes darting in Brûlé's direction. The Sudrin knight laughed to himself. The only peace you'd have without us is the peace of the grave. Brûlé said without looking up. And if you're going to threaten your allies and speak poorly of the very men and women who risked their lives to save you, I would be happy enough to give you that peace.
He paused in the sharpening of his blade, cocking his head in Huck's direction.
If you've steel enough in your blood, friend.
Any man who draws steel against Sir Brûlé draws steel against me. Ian Blakeley appeared from the shadows. He was dressed in only a shirt and the thick leather of his riding breeches, but his hand rested on his sword. The crowd of Teneran soldiers took a long breath to recognize him, then stood as one.
Only words, my lord. You have our faith, Huck said quickly.
Words are the sharpest blade and the easiest to turn, Ian said. He walked past them, standing over the fire to stare down at Sir Brûlé.
I would like to speak to this man in private, please.
The Tenerans were gone in a heartbeat. Brûlé folded his whetstone away, then leaned back, inspecting Ian's appearance. The young lord of Houndhallow looked sallow. His face was thin and puckered with pain, and the way he held his arm betrayed the wound hidden beneath his shirt.
You're going to live? Brûlé asked.
Today at least, unless there is a dagger waiting for my back tonight, Ian said.
The way this lot is talking, I would worry more about your back, Brûlé.
Now children talk. As long as it stays that way, I'm not worried.
I need something from you. Something only you can do.
Someone killed? So you can blame it on the Sudran Knight and kick me out without losing faith among your subjects?
I hope not. But if I give this task to a Teneran, it will certainly lead to a fight, and we can't afford that.
Ian looked stiffly around, then lowered himself to the bench next to Brûlé. There is a shaman among the pagans, a large man, Carl.
Elder of the Tribe of Stones, Brûlé said.
I know him. He's close to Gwen Adair.
I need to know what he's doing, whose counsel he keeps, and whose faith he holds.
You have reason to suspect him? Brûlé asked.
I don't know. Carl was a friend to me, but he was close to Folum's daughter as well. The deeper we get into this, the less I trust those I once called friend.
And why do you trust me?
I don't. But you're alone here. You have no one else to trust, and much to lose in betrayal. Ian smiled thinly, then stood. Let me know what Carl does, who he talks to. If he means to betray me or Gwen, I must be the first to know.
I'm a knight, my lord, not a spy.
And as a knight, you do as you are asked, by your lord.
I've sworn no vow to you, Blakeley.
We must pretend that you have. We must trust one another, Brûlé. We have no one else, you and I.
Ian glanced over at the crowd of Tenerans who watched them still.
My own people don't trust me, though they obey my name. The pagans see the celestial in me. The Tenerans look at my clothes and see a pagan. And both know my father's name and wonder if I will live up to his story.
And when they look at me, they see a Sudran fop, always the enemy, even when alliances are forged.
Brûlé shook his head and stood, then offered Ian his hand.
A desperate business we're in.
Desperate, Ian agreed, but necessary.
They shook hands, then Ian turned and disappeared into the night. Brûlé sat back down and continued sharpening his blade. Whatever this new task would bring, he would need a sharp sword and a clear head. Chapter 2. The knight wore the colors of the celestial church, black and gold, with Cinder's ashen moon on his chest. He rode unsupported across the churned mud of the field, bounding over the bodies of the dead. Leisy arrows fell around him. The line of spearmen at Malcolm Blackley's side wavered. They had withstood a dozen charges from the Celestials under the Reeveholt's watchful towers, but Malcolm didn't think they could handle even one more.
Hold! Hold! Steady, and he will turn! Malcolm wheeled his horse to face the rider, taking the measure of his intent. The loose column of celestial knights along the ridge milled about, as though unsure if they should join their comrade or watch him die alone. The horn signaling their retreat still sounded beyond the ridge. The celestial knight seemed intent on dying a hero. He made no move to turn aside, instead picking up speed as he approached the Teneran line. The steel tip of his spear was aimed unerringly at Malcolm's chest. Malcolm glanced at the spearmen beside him. They were weary from the battle just ended, dragging the bodies of their slain friends back to the Teneran battle line, surprised to be back in the fight even as the enemy withdrew. Even one charging knight could break them. He looked back at the celestial guard, then unsheathed his sword. "I will hold for you," he muttered to himself, then spurred his mount forward. The field between them was littered with bodies and discarded steel. Malcolm gave the horse its head, trusting the beast to navigate the ground without his help. He held the fey iron blade of his sword in both hands, keeping his gaze steady on the rapidly approaching spear. As the distance closed, Malcolm was able to hear the guard's voice, raised above the hammering of hooves and clatter of armor. He was singing the evensong, the dirge of daylight made rough by his battle-weary voice. "To evening fall and ashes spread, end daylight's call in the black embrace of cinder." It was the first time Malcolm had heard the evensong since being chased out of Greenhall by an angry mob. It struck him as strangely out of place on the battlefield. The moment of distraction nearly cost him dearly. In the blink of an eye, the celestial guard was on him. The knight stopped singing, his voice twisting into a scream of rage and retribution. "Cinder!" the knight howled. Their voices crashed together. Malcolm swung his sword. He was aiming for the haft of the spear, but instead the blade glanced off its steel tip. The spear's aim wavered, drawn off from Malcolm's heart, cutting instead into his shoulder. It snagged the rings of his chain shirt, popping links open like the burst seam of a wineskin. The two knights collided, the force of the impact sending Malcolm reeling in his saddle. Instinctively, his horse wheeled around, again almost throwing Malcolm to the ground. The Duke of Houndhallow gripped the pommel, his left arm hanging loose at his side. The impact had numbed it, but a quick look showed no blood in the gap. His armor had saved him. Malcolm's sword slithered down his mount's side, disappearing into the grass. The celestial knight wheeled to face Malcolm, dropping the shattered remnants of his spear and drawing an iron mace from his belt. "Do you yield to the church's mercy, Sir Blakeley?" "The church has forsaken mercy, sir," Malcolm answered. His head was spinning. "I will not risk it, now or ever." "Then be damned!" The knight spurred his horse, and it leapt toward Malcolm. With his good hand, Malcolm drew his dagger, the only weapon left to him. They met again, the knight swinging wildly at Malcolm's head, easily dodged, and then the backstroke skated across Malcolm's forearm. Their knees met, and Malcolm leaned into the contact, throwing his numb arm across the man's shoulders, fouling his swing. Malcolm dragged his dagger across the knight's chest, the sharp edge grinding along steel and dancing off chain, finally catching beneath the plate protecting the man's thigh. The haft of his knight's mace caught Malcolm in the jaw, shoving his helm to the side, blinding him and pushing him back. Malcolm hung onto the dagger, driving the tip of the blade into the knight's thigh. Screams filled Malcolm's ears, his own and the knight's, and possibly more voices beyond. Malcolm pitched forward, crashed into the knight, his full weight on the dagger's hilt. There was half a breath of resistance, then chain links popped and the dagger drove home. Screaming, they fell. The ground met Malcolm with dark arms. His head buzzed, eyes swimming with colors, sweat and blood running down his face. He struggled to breathe. Still blinded by his helm, Malcolm wrenched himself onto his knees, doubling up as nausea swept through his body, biting back the bile in his mouth. With numb fingers, Malcolm twisted off his helm, throwing it aside. The line of his spearmen washed over him, charging in to surround their lord. The celestial knights on the ridge had finally decided to join their comrades' lonely charge, and were even now breaking against the reinvigorated spear wall. The sound of their hooves thundered in Malcolm's head, shaking through his bones and chattering his teeth. The spears held, spitting any rider foolish enough to meet them. One of the spearmen rushed past Malcolm to the fallen knight at his side. He drove his spear into the knight's chest, leaning on it until the screaming stopped. He turned to Malcolm.
"My lord, your blade."
"Yes, I..." Malcolm struggled to draw breath. His chest was tight, and his vision swam.
"I lost it. Dropped it somewhere, bloody thing." "At your knee, my lord."
Malcolm gaped up at the man, not understanding. The spearman knelt, scooping up the fey iron blade that was lying in the grass at Malcolm's knee. He offered Malcolm the hilt across his forearms, as though he were a king offering a commission. Smiling wryly, Malcolm took the sword, then used it to stand up. The spearman remained kneeling for half a second, then scrambled to his feet and rejoined his comrades. The skirmish rolled around them, until finally the knights tired of wheeling and broke back to the ridgeline. Malcolm gathered his spearmen, counted the newly dead, and signaled the retreat. They marched wearily back to the Teneran lines. Castian Jardin was waiting for him on the Teneran battle line. The Duke of Redgarden had waited calmly during the battle, receiving reports from the scattered bands of fighters who made up Malcolm's makeshift army. They had told him that when Lady Bastion's forces had been split up, betrayed by the priests of Cinder and the ranks of Celestial Guard, they'd flown in all directions. Some had found their way to Malcolm's line, others had fled into the woods, and the majority had run back to the south. The Celestials had pursued, creating a confusing battlefield of small skirmishes, limited engagements, and sudden conflict. They had also told him that Malcolm's forces had spent the day rushing around, trying to save elements of the shattered Bastion force, while still avoiding a direct fight with the Celestials. The betrayal of the priests of Cinder had thrown the entire battlefield into disarray, from unclear loyalties to murky battle lines, and it was up to Jardin to sort it all out.
"Houndallow, what news from the front?"
Jardin asked. He was still in battle armor, though he had exchanged his helm for a farmer's sun cap and removed his greaves to better handle the maps and written reports.
"My only news is that the front's all over the bloody place. We engaged a small patrol just this side of the tallow, but they were reinforced by mounted knights and a small cadre of archers."
Malcolm accepted a bowl of water from a servant, drinking deeply before dumping the remainder over his head. Dirt and blood washed down his face. "They withdrew in short order, but not before one of their number decided to die a zealot's death."
"Another story for the Reaver Bane's legend,"
Jardin said.
"No wonder the Sudrans fear you so."
"It wasn't my kill.
I dropped my sword and very nearly my head. Had to be saved by some farmer's son." "Then a story for that man's grandchildren. God's bless."
Jardin rifled through his reports, grimacing.
"It's the same everywhere, Malcolm. Small battles, small deaths. We're staying away from the Celestials as best we can, but sometimes the fight can't be dodged."
"What of Bastion's forces? Have any more sued for our aid?"
"Some," Jardin said. "It would help if their fellows would do the same. A few of them are still trying to fight us. Half these reports are of skirmishes fought between our men and Bastion's, with the priests of Cinder, the very ones who attacked them, watching from afar."
"Gods, we kill each other, and the wolf waits at the door. Has there been any sign of Lady Bastion,
or any of her command.
Not yet.
A few knights have joined us. They tell of Lady Bastion falling back along the road, toward the Reeveholt. Perhaps Bourne offered her sanctuary.
Not bloody likely. That man was as loyal to Adair as any in the north. I doubt he'll suffer Sudran guests at his table. Not unless they force the door. We'll have to pray she lives. These Sudran knights, are they fighting for us, or merely tolerating our company?
I thought it best to keep them off the field, at least until the fog of war has passed. They're gathered in a tent, back in camp. The Vow Knight is watching them.
Truo? Very well. I shall speak to them, before she poisons their minds any further.
Malcolm slid from his saddle, landing with a wince. His legs and back were as brittle as dry wood, and just as stiff.
God's bless, but war is a young man's business.
Malcolm made his slow way back to the makeshift camp. The sudden addition of Sudran rank and file from Bastion's shattered army had thrown the camp into disarray, and the once straight lines of tents and wagons looked like a game of scatterjacks now. Order would have to be re-established if they were going to face the Celestial Army with a unified front. He was able to find the tent holding the Sudran knights easily enough. An informal ring of Teneran guards circled it, none of them assigned to stand watch, and yet all unwilling to allow Sudran nobility to roam freely through the camp. Malcolm nodded his way through their salutes, then ducked into the tent and closed the flap behind him. The Sudran knights were gathered tightly at the center of the tent, holding a whispered conversation. They fell silent when Malcolm entered, turning as one to face him. The dim light inside the tent prevented him from identifying any of them. Malcolm tried to laugh, but managed only a dust-choked croak and a cough.
"Sirs," Malcolm said, "some of you I know from tournaments. Some I've not had the honor of meeting."
He threw his gloves down on a camp stool, then held out his hands. "I am Lord Malcolm Blakeley, Duke of Houndhallow, and by Shrice Grace, the commander of this force. I have..."
"We know who you are, Reaverbane."
One of the inky shapes in the center of the tent stepped forward, resolving into a tall knight in simple armor. She held her helm in the crook of her arm, and rested a hand on the hilt of a northern-style broadsword. Malcolm didn't need to see her face to know her. He recognized her voice.
"Sir Tars, we have not crossed blades since the All-Fire tourney at Hartsbridge, 3 seasons past," Malcolm said. "I'm sorry today's meeting is under less glorious conditions."
"Save your words," Tars answered. "We want to know how you bent those shamans to your will, and how you snuck them into our ranks. The North has never stooped this low before, killing priests, summoning demons in open battle. I thought you were better than this, Houndhallow."
"I know less than you, Tars."
Malcolm held his hands away from his blade, though he needn't have bothered. The sound of Teneran guards moving outside the tent was threat enough. "The first we knew of the priests of Cinder's attack upon their own army was when a group of your knights told us of it and threw themselves upon our mercy. It came as a complete surprise to us. They said the Inquisitors themselves were using words of ancient power to kill." Tars snorted and turned away. 2 other Sudran knights took her place. They could have been sisters or even twins, but sported different tabards and had distinctly different accents. They wore their golden red hair in thick plaits and held their thin noses aloft, as though the air itself offended them.
"I am Sir Tabata Hallister, sworn blade of the Earl of Delspont, here to avenge the honour of Sudran sons and daughters, dead at pagan hands. Whatever happened out there, it was the work of geists and pagan trickery. I have heard well of you, Reaverbane, but the hearts of men change, as well as their loyalty."
"You swear you had nothing to do with this?" the other woman asked.
She wore 2 blades, each half the length of a regular sword. They were favoured by captains in the navy,
short enough for close-quarters work and fit for cutting ropes and heavy board without turning their edge. "You have my word and my heart, sir." Malcolm inclined his head. "Sir Travellet, Gabriel Travellet, I ride at the pleasure of Duke Bassion, though I am often abroad. I came home from 2 years at sea to find my beloved Tenumbra torn asunder. There are many who say I have you to thank for that." "Sir Travellet, I am as sundered as our shared island. There has been treachery within the church, a betrayal that strikes at both Tenere and Sudra. We have all lost sons and daughters, sometimes to honest battle, sometimes to a knife in the dark." Malcolm paused, remembering Sir Dugan's possession and death. He shivered. "Sometimes worse. Now is not the time for accusation. And yet you accuse members of the Holy Church, when it was your man, Lord Adair, who betrayed us all," Sir Hallister said, bristling. "Or do you deny his heresy?" "I do not. But his betrayal is nothing compared to that of Thomas Secombra. And now the High Inquisitor's heresy seems to have spread. Your fellows report the attack upon your army came from the ranks of Inquisitors, from your own allies. I believe that we are fighting the same enemy as struck down both Colmadair and Gabriel Halvert," Malcolm said. "It was no agent of the church who raised the Geist in Greenhall. That was pagan work and a pagan god," Tass said from the side. "You'll forgive me, but I was there when Halvert died. I saw..." "Not that," Tass said, cutting Malcolm off. "I speak of the devastation of Greenhall. A god rose from the stones of the city, destroying buildings and killing untold innocents. It took all of Lady Halvert's strength to put it down. The only reason she hasn't joined us yet is because she is still trying to secure her broken walls." "I have heard nothing of this. How do you know it was pagan work, and not the same treachery that laid low the Fen Gate?" "We are arguing distant treachery when there is a knife at our throat," Sir Hallister said. She shouldered Travellet out of the way and punched her finger into Malcolm's chest. "How did those pagans get in our ranks?"
"They weren't pagans." This new voice came from behind the Sudran knights, low and quiet. Malcolm looked over Travellet's shoulder. There was a fourth figure, huddled on a camp stool. "They were my brothers, my friends, or so I thought."
"My lady, you saw the attack?" Malcolm asked. The woman stood. She was a priest of Cinder, though her robes were muddied and her face smudged with ash.
"God save me, I did," she said. "Priests of Cinder summoning pagan geists and using them to murder their brethren. A dark blade turned against itself."
Chapter 3. He was a young man, barely old enough to shave, certainly young enough to be Gwen's age. He had the Teneran look about him, dark hair, darker eyes, pale skin that was marred with grime from the prison cell. He was dressed in priestly robes, though not of the Celestial Church. Gwen could almost see her younger brother in his eyes, could see what Grieg might have become if Secombra hadn't killed the boy, along with her mother and father. She tightened her grip on the spear, then nodded to the guards. They unlocked the young man's cell and stepped aside. Gwen knew she made a frightful sight. Her face and arms were slashed with the wounds sustained in the siege of Hound Hollow, but the thin flakes of iron that had formed from her blood had turned to rust, disintegrating into the weeks after the battle. Her skin was stained red and black, especially around her eyes and the corners of her mouth. Even her hair had taken on the look of ruined iron. The priest looked unfazed, though. No doubt he had seen his share of horror in Folum Voidfather's company.
"Are you here to kill me, witch?" the priest asked.
"What is your name?"
"My name? So you can conjure with it? Put a curse on my eyes and wither my heart while I still live?
No, I don't think I'll be telling you my name.
He sat up, neck bent against the rune-inscribed iron collar, chains rattling.
But I know yours. Gwendolyn Adair, Witch of the Fen Gate. Only the Fen Gate has fallen, hasn't it? Look, I need to call you something, so I'm going to go with idiot. Is that okay with you?
The boy grinned and was about to speak when Gwen continued.
So, idiot, what brought you to Hound Hallow? You haven't broken out, so you're clearly not one of those void priests we'd heard so much about. You're too scrawny to fight, and too dumb to give orders. So why the hell are you here, idiot?
What do you know, witch? I could be one of the acolytes. Your shamans wouldn't have put these spellbound chains on me if you didn't think it was a possibility.
The chains are for me, Gwen said. They're to keep me from killing you, idiot.
The boy's smile faltered, and one hand drifted instinctively to the iron at his neck. But he kept talking.
Death is just another form of emptiness, witch. Another aspect of the one true God. You can't threaten me with that. I go where the Void Father has walked already.
His smile deepened, confidence returning to his words.
I go where I was destined to go.
Maybe.
But I can make the journey there a hell of a lot less pleasant than you imagine.
She dropped the tip of her spear down to the boy's throat, sliding the razor-sharp tip up his jaw until it drew blood at the lobe of his left ear.
You're a zealot. I know the type. Anxious to die. Not so anxious to suffer. Especially if none of your fellow zealots are around to witness your sacrifice. They're all gone, idiot. Your void priests, Folum, the pagans you lured to your service, and the priests corrupted by your heresy, all dead.
Do you believe that?
Good.
He leaned gingerly back, avoiding Gwen's spear, until his head rested against the stone wall of the cell.
Rest safe in your bed, Gwendolyn Adair. I'm sure there's nothing to worry about.
No, no. I'm not falling for that.
I've figured out your type. Creepy and self-assured.
I should never have trusted Folum. I see that now. And that other one, Aiden. The one who went to kill Sir Le Fay and never came back. He was one of yours too, I'm sure of it.
I won't fall for that trap again.
Won't you? You certainly weren't able to protect yourself from Folum Voidfather or his witch daughter.
You weren't even able to protect your family from themselves. And here you are, asking questions of an idiot, apparently not powerful enough to defend himself.
Tell me, witch, why am I still alive? Why do you need me?
Gwen snarled, but didn't answer.
The priest adjusted himself on the floor, sitting up a little straighter, smiling a little brighter.
Because you don't know, do you? You don't know anything. Folum took you into his trust, then used you to strike at Greenhall. They blame you for that, by the way. You and Dead Sacombra, and all the priests of the Celestial Church. Sudra is tearing itself apart, trying to decide who is more responsible for their dead sons and broken thrones. And Tenere can't field an army to defend itself without first being accused of heresy by the Church, betrayal by their own brothers, or worse.
Poor Malcolm Blakeley has fled the Fen Gate. He trailed off, seeing Gwen's reaction.
Surely you knew that. Your home is in celestial hands, witch. Our hands. What secrets will they find? What new heresies will the Inquisition lay at your family's feet?
I care nothing for the Church's condemnation or Sudra's trouble. They've earned their discord, and may the gods usher them to it. I'm here for Tenere and the old gods.
I am of the old gods, witch. Are we allies, then?
Whatever god you serve, it has nothing to do with the spirits of this world. Folum may have commanded respect among the tribes.
but I've seen enough to know that he served a different kind of god. So sure, and yet so foolish. And you name me idiot. The priest stood, shoulders slumped under the weight of his chains. But as he shuffled toward Gwen, she took a step back. Do you think I'm alone, witch? I'm never alone. Not here, nor in Hartsbridge, nor Cinderfell. Send me to any court in Tenumbra, and I will count my brothers and sisters hidden in their ranks. The true faith is coming through. If you swear to the old gods, why do you kill our shamans? Why do you threaten the tribes? If we're both fighting against the Celestial Church, there is no difference, witch. Your feral gods and the bound gods of Hartsbridge, there is no difference. They're all just whispers before the shout, lightning before the thunder, and in the end, emptiness. The priest laughed, then grabbed Gwen's spear. She twisted it out of his hands, swearing. He held up his hands, palm first, to show the blood she had drawn. Threaten me all you want, but I'm not your enemy. You'll see, in the end. You'll understand. This is all I need to understand. Folum betrayed me. Sacombra betrayed me. The tribes betrayed me. My family is dead. And my friends have abandoned me as a heretic. All I have left are these few who stand with me. So, if you want to make threats, you're going to have to come up with something better. Look at your allies, witch. Ian Blakeley, whose father led Hulvert to your gates, and whose army hunted you through the fen. There are Sudrans within the walls of your sanctuary, brought to Hound Hallow by Ian. And who was it that counseled Ian in the wilderness and brought him to the fen gate just in time to play the hero? The witch Fianna and the shaman Carl. Fianna, daughter of Folum. And isn't Carl still at your side? It seems convenient that Ian and Carl both survived the Inquisition's hand, just to stand with you now. You will not have me questioning my allies. You're a stubborn girl. Join us, and be assured of victory. Be assured of your revenge against those who... Oh. He looked down at his belly, and Gwen's spear protruding from it. I thought we were talking. I am done talking, Gwen spat. The priest slid to the floor, staring up at her with eyes wide in pain and shock. Bury this one with the horses, and see that his name is forgotten. I die in the house of my sword, the priest murmured. He grimaced, forcing the words out. Forged under your nose and... Gwen twisted the spear and withdrew it. The priest's belly came with it, spilling out across the floor. The boy gasped, eyes fluttering, then fell silent. Never mind, Gwen said. Just burn the body with the rest of the shit. I won't have him poisoning my water. What did he mean, m'lady? The guard asked. Gwen looked at him askance. He was one of Ian's bannermen, wearing the Blakeley hound on his chest. Dying in the house of his sword. What was that about? Damned if I know, she said. Tell your master I need to speak with him, if you can find him. Ian and I have much to discuss. Carl waited until the light from Gwen's torch was gone, then stood from his corner. The stone pulled away from him like a cloak, forming back into the wall that had concealed him. He had been on his way to question the priest when Gwen arrived, and barely had time to hide before the Huntress of Adair was upon him. He went to stand over the dead priest. Your secrets go with you, he whispered. But you have left poison enough behind. How is she supposed to trust anyone with those sorts of lies in her ear? The priest didn't answer. Carl grunted, then made his way to the door. It wouldn't be long before the guard came back for the body, and it wouldn't do for Carl to be found at his side. Carl was troubled.
Ever since Fianna had been taken by the Inquisition, given over by Ian's father for the sin of saving his wife, Carl had been on uncertain ground. As the Elder of Stone, Carl was used to a firm foundation, but so many things had stopped making sense when Fianna had left him. A troubled company filled the courtyard of Hound Hollow. The Sudren Knights had formed up near the stables, guarding their mounts and setting up a perimeter around their fires. Most had struck their colors, but a stubborn few wore the bright tabards of their sworn houses. Some had adopted the Hound of Blakeley, but the Tenerans of that house clearly didn't trust them. Whatever their colors, the Sudrans all watched the surrounding pagan hosts with nervous eyes, hands on hilts. The Tenerans were none better. The few remaining Blakeley guards had no love for the pagans, who only weeks ago had assaulted their walls and murdered their friends. The few Tenerans of other houses at Hound Hollow seemed to be always in armor, always peering over their shoulders. For the pagans, life inside the walls of a castle was no more comfortable. They walked in anxious packs, sticking close together, like pups trailing after their mother. The pagans spent as much time outside the walls as possible, but the woods were haunted by feral gods that answered to neither the shaman's commands nor the pagans' prayers. The fact that this castle belonged to Blakeley, the first of the northern tribes to abandon the old faith and bend the knee to the Celestriarch, did little to comfort the pagans' fears. It was not a settled company. Each faction had good reason to mistrust the others, and there were swords enough in their number to see everyone dead. A group of clansmen from the Tribe of Stone stood around the entrance to the dungeons, keeping watch. Carl joined them. "The priest is dead. Gwen didn't get what she wanted out of him," he said. "None of us will now." "We tried to warn you she was coming," one of the pagans, a youth named Cairn, whispered. "Did you learn anything?"
"I learned that Gwen Adair doesn't trust us. Doesn't trust anyone. Hard to blame her, the problems she's had."
"And how are we supposed to trust her then? A lot of the tribes are looking to her to lead, now that Folum's dead and the rest of the elders argue among themselves."
"Maybe better if she doesn't trust anyone. I'd have given Folum Voidfather my life before he used us to set Sudra against us. God knows Folum might have been in on this from the beginning. Might have been Sakombra's friend."
Carl grimaced, staring at a group of Blakeley guards as they passed. What if Fianna was part of this as well? Folum was her father, as the priest said. What poison might she have laid on Ian's ears? She did talk a lot about grooming Ian to become the Hound of the Hollow, to reclaim his family's place among the pagan tribes. If she were working for these void priests... Carl shook his head, grunting. He couldn't start down that line of thought. He had enough enemies. "Watch the gates," he said. "Worst thing that could happen is if they locked us in here, cut us off from the rest of the tribes, cut us off from the gods."
"Those things in the woods are no gods of mine," Cairn said.
"No. No, they're not. But keep watch."
"And where are you going?"
"Time I talk to Ian. We haven't seen much of each other since Fianna was taken.
His guards are keeping him close. You won't be able to get within 100 paces of his lordship," Cairn said with a smirk.
"This is a house of stones," Carl said, pushing off from the wall and heading toward the gate. "And I'm the Elder of Stones. I will find a way."
Carl didn't notice the eyes that watched him walk out of the gate. A group of men, wearing the Hound and skulking in the shadows of the gate, signaled to each other. Another man, Sudren by birth, but wearing the Hound on a newly stitched tabard, came out of the gatehouse.
"I will follow him," Brûlé said.
"Stay here. Watch his tribesmen."
"Will you be safe?" one of the guards asked.
"None of us are. Not while that lot walks free through our gates." He shrugged and loosened his sword.
"But I have my orders. Keep safe, and if I don't come back, see that Sir Blakeley is informed."
Chapter 4. Whatever fragment of hope Frère Lucas harbored for finding aid from Sophie Halvert was crushed by their first sight of Greenhall. The weeks since Thomas Sicombre's escape and untimely death had brought tales of Halvert's zealotry, told by frightened priests of Cinder fleeing south. But Lucas knew of nowhere else to turn. The stories were enough to get Lucas to change out of his vestments and store them in his saddlebags, replacing them with a scholar's cowl and loose robes. The icons he stowed away in his satchel. His staff he disguised with leather wraps and a thick leather traveller's parcel. His sole companion, Martin Roard, the heir of Stormwatch, had no need for a disguise. He wore the same simple linen and tabard of red and yellow he donned when he joined Lucas's company. Sicombre was gone, but his servants and fellow heretics were everywhere. If Sophie could separate her hatred for Sicombre from her fear of Cinder's priests, she would be a valuable ally, if not a dangerous enemy, and all signs pointed to the latter. At first, Lucas thought the city was burning. A thick cloud of smoke hung over it, drifting through the streets like a pestilence. Open flames flickered along the parapets. The walls of the city were hung with banners that bore the sigil of Lady Strife in her aspect of crusader, a red sun crossed by a burning sword. Another banner flew from the keep. From a distance, it looked like the tri-acorn of Halvert, crossed in gold. But as they approached the city, Lucas was able to make out the details. The acorns were replaced with tongues of flame. "Lady Halvert has taken to the faith most strongly," Lucas said. "There were signs of this when we passed through, but it has not traveled so far." "Nor so furiously," Martin said. He pointed to the former tourney ground, the site of the attacks that started this whole affair. The stands had finally been torn down, but their lumber was repurposed. Rows of X-shaped crosses lined the jousting field. Most were occupied, though their victims were long dead. Flocks of crows wheeled over the field, crying their joy. "She was always a zealot, as was her father, but this is beyond the pale. Who are they even killing? Most of the faithful of Cinder had already fled the last time we were here, and surely there weren't this many pagans hiding in the slums." They followed the slow procession of traffic going into the city, which swung in a wide detour, forcing all those who wished to enter to pass by the jousting field and its harvest of crosses. The smell of death disconcerted the horses. "We had better lead the mounts from here. I wouldn't want to crack my skull in Halvert's court." A group of men waited at the head of the crossrow. They wore robes of dirty white cloth, their chests emblazoned with the flames and cross of the banner that flew over Greenhall, done in cheap paint with little skill. All of them wore their hair short, though it looked as though if their scalps had been burned clean rather than shorn. An angry red welt traveled down their shoulders and across their faces. Their leader was a man of considerable age, the patchy stubble on his head and face as white as snow. "A pox on winter and spring eternal, the bright lady on earth, light unending," the man called to the passing travellers. He carried a dented censer, but instead of incense, the brass cage on the end of the chain was filled with burning coals. The man swung it precariously close to any who wandered near. "A crusade on winter. The true light of the celestial church is risen. This is the dawn, and we are the sun." "God bless them, but they're going to kill themselves with those flames," Martin muttered. The travellers around them kept their heads down, staring at their feet as they passed the zealots. Martin simply stared. Has some madness gripped this town?
"Madness and the bright lady," Lucas said, glancing up just long enough to take in the rows of dead. "Though this feels like more than strife's usual instability. These are peasants, killed for no reason I can see. We have to get to Sophie. We have to figure out what's going on here."
I can tell you what's going on. The speaker wore the leather apron and calluses of a blacksmith, though her voice was gentle. Sophie Halvert has gone mad. She's changed Strife's hope into Cinder's terror. God's know how this will end.
Not well, Martin said. The zealots had turned toward him, noticing his stares, and were now preaching their crusade directly to him. He ducked his head and hurried forward. Surely Sophie is not allowing murder in her streets.
It's not murder if there are no courts, the smith said. You'll not find a judge or inquisitor within 100 miles of these walls. Not if they know what's good for them, you won't. Lucas didn't answer, just pressed forward into the crowd. Their horses followed reluctantly, eyes wide at the fire and the stink of death on all sides. The guards at the gate paid no heed to Martin and Lucas. Inside the gate, the crowds pressed close on all sides. Lucas was forced to slow to a snail's pace. The streets were piled with rubble, and many of the buildings were burned out or abandoned.
Was there an attack here? Lucas asked. These people look like they survived something horrific.
And the buildings?
We were just here, not a month ago, but I saw no signs of an army at their walls, no siege works, none of the ravage left by a besieging army. And yet there has clearly been violence.
They came around a corner and caught sight of the old town. A crater lay at the center of the district, and the buildings nearby leaned toward it, like parishioners bowing to an altar.
A great deal of violence, he said quietly.
A geist, Lucas answered.
If I dare draw on the nether, I'm sure it would be obvious. But what sort of geist can do this much damage?
We both know the answer to that. We were at the Fen Gate. We saw Gwen's manifestation and the destruction that she wrought.
4 decades I've been...
Lucas trailed off, suddenly aware of the ears all around and the danger of talking about the Inquisition.
What happened to Gwen was unusual. It was singular.
And yet, Martin said, nodding to the crater, the road turned, bending toward the keep. Scaffolding climbed the walls, crawling with workers. Even the keep was damaged.
We need to figure out what has happened here, and I'm willing to bet that our answers will lie at the center of that crater, Lucas said.
Our plan was to go to the keep, to seek Sophie Halvert's aid in hunting Sacombra's rescuers, Martin said. Otherwise, why did we come all this way?
The plan has changed, young Stormwatch. I don't think Sophie would hear us anyway, and I have no interest in being fitted for one of those crosses.
This way, he said, turning down a side alley. Lucas and Martin moved through the city like rabbits through a field, afraid of the hawks circling overhead. The streets were still crowded, though no one had the attention to spare an old scholar and his man-at-arms. If the rest of Greenhall was in the throes of religious zealotry, the old town was held in a kind of hallowed tranquility, the sacred heart of silence. The crowds thinned, and the rubble by the side of the road took on a religious weight, as though those tumble-down buildings were the relics of some divine event, as holy as it was destructive. Some survivors wandered the wreckage. Most were dressed in ragged linen robes, bleached white and bearing the tri-flame and cross. They were sifting through the rubble, searching for fragments of their former lives, or maybe relics of whatever new religion had settled on the people of Greenhall.
Do you think they'll rebuild? Martin asked. Not if it's holy to them.
We never rebuilt Cinderfell, did we? Cinderfell, the holiest site of the god of winter, was the place where Cinder descended to the earth to quench his flames in a lake. The lands around the lake were blasted for miles in all directions, the trees flattened and black.
That's different, Martin said. I'm not so sure, Lucas answered. The air here is humming, bright. Something happened here, but I wouldn't call it holy.
The geography of the city slowly descended, as though the earth collapsed in on itself. The closer they got to the crater, the more difficult the going became. They had to abandon the horses for the last part of the journey. Martin tied them up on a broken beam behind the remains of a watchtower.
"God's pray no one steals them," he said.
"There's no one here," Luca said. "We haven't seen a soul in 20 minutes.
"No, we haven't," Martin agreed.
He looked around at the broken buildings, suppressing a shiver.
"But I can't shake the feeling that we're being followed."
Lucas didn't answer. His eyes were on the crater.
"Something is waiting. Has been waiting for a long time," Lucas said.
"Should we continue? Is it safe?"
"No,"
Lucas said, then started scrambling down into the crater. Martin loosened his sword and followed. The final descent was harsh, a steep slide into darkness. Halfway down, Martin wondered aloud if they'd even be able to crawl back out. Lucas didn't answer. They tumbled the last 10 feet, landing in a cloud of dust and scree.
"What is this place?"
Martin asked, rolling to his feet. Clouds of dust hung around them, and only a little light came down from above, even though it was nearly noon.
"I don't know, but I mean to find out. It has a familiar feel to it," Lucas said.
He had brought his satchel of holy items and took the time to unsling the staff of icons, using it to help him stand. He coughed into his hand as he peered into the darkness.
"I have been in such a place before," he said, "in the fen."
"You're saying this is a hallow?"
"It was, or something similar. But no, the witch's hallow in the fen wasn't just a place of veneration. It was a tomb, a sanctuary, a place to hide the fen god from the church."
Lucas raised his hand, and thin lines of purple light trailed from his fingertips. His eyes flashed once, then nether mist began leaking down his cheeks. He inhaled sharply.
"This feels different, like a prison."
"Why is there a pagan shrine underneath Greenhall? Gabriel Halvert was strict in his faith. The man shrouded himself in Freyrwood and had his own cadre of inquisitors to keep the Gheists at bay.
He may not have known it was here. The hallows used to stretch from shore to shore. Most of the holy sites of the celestial faith are just converted pagan shrines. Greenhall had a henge long before it had a domer, but this doesn't feel like those places."
Lucas gestured, and a shower of deep purple sparks fluttered away from him, spiraling through the darkness like fireflies. They landed on stone walls, the remnants of a dome, and a small shrine deep in the shadows. Their light turned the dust hanging in the air into gilt.
Lucas grunted. "This seems the core of it. Do you have a torch?"
Martin went to one knee, swinging his bag onto the ground. In moments, he had a flame going, filling the chamber with orange light. Lucas motioned him toward the shrine. It was small and black, made from some soft, lustrous stone that reflected the torch's light. The shrine was small, no larger than a wagon strongbox, but intricately worked. The base of the shrine was carved to resemble a man lying on his back, chest split open and arms thrown wide. A pillar of flowers erupted from the wound in his heart, the petals spreading wider and wider until they split into 5 parts, each of which descended to the edges of the shrine. Each descending arc landed on the supine figure, one on each hand and foot, the last on the man's forehead. Lucas bent to examine it more closely.
"More than petals," he muttered, running his finger over the pillar. "Blades and bones, a broken skull, all the makings of war. And look."
He turned his attention to the figure's face.
"He's crying, joyfully."
"Do you know what god this represents?" Martin asked.
The true goddess Summer.
The voice came from the lip of the crater. Martin lifted the torch, though that only served to blind him. Lucas pushed the torch aside, peering up at the speaker. It was a boy, or half a boy. He had a child's height, but one side of his head was covered in white, brittle hair, like an old man. When he swept the cascade of hair aside, they could see that half of his face hung in wrinkles and age spots, while the other side was smooth and young, if haunted. The hand on that side was thin, knotted with arthritis, the skin hanging in loose, spotted folds. "I knew you would come," the boy said. "That is why he spared me. To be here when you came. To protect the place of his birth."
"I have no interest in hurting a child," Martin said.
He held his hands well away from his blade. "Don't make me do anything we'll both regret."
"The child has no interest in hurting you either," the boy said.
Yet this time, the decrepit half of his face was more animated, and his voice growled with the roughness of age.
"But I have no such compunction. Tell us who you are,"
Lucas shouted. The boy's wrinkled face smiled, but the young eye started to weep. Lucas turned to Martin.
"Be ready to run."
"Where am I supposed to run?" Martin asked, looking around. A crack of thunder drew their attention back to the boy. He was descending into the crater, his feet dragging along the scree as he floated down, arms wide, like the figure on the shrine. Burning petals spun from his open mouth. Martin jumped onto the opposite side of the crater, scrambling for height. Debris tumbled around his hands and feet, starting an avalanche. The crater filled with dust once again. Shafts of light, thrown by the boy as well as from the sun above, turned the air into a hatchwork.
"You came to learn what I was, Inquisitor. Why do you run even as I present myself? How can you learn as you flee?"
"I'm not running anywhere, demon," Lucas snapped. He threw his arms wide, sweeping his staff in a semicircle. A gust of wind flew from him, clearing the air.
"Whatever you are, I will banish you. Wherever you flee, I will hunt you down."
"Then we will both die here. That is acceptable." The boy touched down, balancing on one toe, the rest of his body held aloft by unseen forces.
"I have many bodies, many blossoms, more every day. This is very fertile ground."
Lucas didn't waste any more time talking. He struck, wrapping nether around his fist, punching toward the boy geist. The force of his blow scattered the carpet of flower petals, accumulating at the boy's feet, but the dark lines of netheric force broke against the geist without moving him. Lucas set his feet and pushed harder. Stones flew from the ground, peeling away from the floor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.